Over at microcosmos.store, you can pick up your very own Microcosmos microscope. It comes with 4 plan objectives to ensure the sharpest possible image, and using the included mount, you can capture images like the ones you're seeing right now, all of which were recorded on our microscope. Check it out today at microcosmos.store. In the 1820s, a man named Dr. R. Brandis walked through a meadow on a quest to try to answer a centuries-old question that had recently begun to spark discussion among his own correspondences. Several of his acquaintances had come across masses of a mysterious gelatinous substance on the ground known as star jelly, but no one knew what it could possibly be. But on the list of possibilities was this, a bacteria called Nostoc. Our first discoveries of bacteria are generally credited to Robert Hooke and Antony van Leeuwenhoek, who wielded their microscopes to explore the invisible worlds embedded in our surroundings and reported back with descriptions of tiny living things. Their work goes back to the 17th century, relatively recent as far as human endeavors go, and yet our knowledge of Nostoc is much, much older, going back at least 1600 years, when they were featured in Chinese writings describing their use as food. And somehow, the bacteria was named Nostoc in the 16th century before we knew that bacteria existed. How? How could we know about a bacteria before we knew about bacteria? How could we see them, let alone eat them, or name them, or write about them? How could someone like Dr. Brandis possibly look at a lump of jelly on the ground and think it has anything to do with the little dots that we need a microscope to see right now? Well, it's because Nostoc don't actually live as a single little set of dots on their own. They are part of something larger than them. Much, much larger. They exist as a colony, a mass of Nostoc held together, like these ones. Nostoc are cyanobacteria, and the individual cells are usually shaped like spheres or ovals. These cells are attached to each other, forming the short strands that we see here, which are called trichomes. But not all the cells of the Nostoc are the same. Life in a colony means that different cells can take on different tasks, instead of having to try and accomplish everything at once. Some specialize in reproduction, while others fix nitrogen to help the cells grow. And some rare cells remain dormant behind thick walls. Their main task is survival, ensuring the Nostoc colony can grow from something again should environmental conditions take a turn for the worse. There are several hundred species of Nostoc that we know of, and there is a wide range of sizes to these colonies. Some are only a few millimeters in diameter, while others, like Nostoc pruniform, can get up to 22 centimeters in diameter. For the Americans out there, that's almost a foot. The thing that holds these trichomes together so that they can accumulate at these larger sizes is a gelatinous matrix made of sugars. We've actually been staring at this jelly structure the entire time, but it's hard to see because the cells within it are so still. The gelatinous shell just melts into the background. But you can see it here, or rather you can see the jelly shell being poked and prodded at by a creature on the other side of it. That matrix does more than hold the colony together. It protects it, keeping it safe from solar radiation and other dangers in the environment. And as you might have guessed, the gelatinous structure is the magic behind the mystery mucus piles that people have found lying on the ground. In fact, the name Nostoc is like a roundabout tribute to these squishy lumps. In the 16th century, there was a scientist and alchemist named Areolus Philippus Theophrastus Bombastus von Hohenheim, though he became known by the much shorter and a lot less fun, Paracelsus. Paracelsus was particularly fascinated by folklore, and as he traveled throughout Western Europe, he often talked to peasants and craftsmen and other folks who might be able to tell him about things like witch's jelly, another phrase used to describe Nostoc. Paracelsus was the one who gave the organism the name it is known by today, drawing on the Old English and German words for nostril. The inspiration for choosing a variation on nostril comes, we assume, from the very booger-like appearance of the Nostoc, the clumpy green masses they form along the ground. One 17th century writer described Nostoc as, quote, excrement blown from the nostrils of some rheumatic planet, falling upon spacious plains, fields, and sheep pastures. The fascination with Nostoc came because their lumpy jelly bodies seemed to come out of nowhere, but were often associated with rain or shooting stars. It's why their numerous names include things like spittle of the stars and star slime. We now know why Nostoc are capable of such surprising appearances. It's not that they come from nowhere. Rather, they come from a dry, desiccated state that renders them brittle and dark against the ground and thus easily missed. They survive these times thanks in part to the sugars surrounding them, which keep them protected from this dry state. And when it rains, their bodies fill with water, expanding the matrix and thus the colony into something that we can see and touch and feel and, yes, sometimes even eat. So when Dr. Brandis investigated the meadow for the masses of gelatinous lumps he found there, Nostoc was a distinct possibility. One apothecary he cited found a Nostoc species on the ground that sounded similar in some ways, but his mass was different. It was a very distinct white color, and it looked more like frog eggs, though not quite frog eggs. He did what anyone obsessed with a frustrating identification problem would do, and dove into the literature, coming out with a conclusion. What he had found was snail spawn. And who are we to dissuade him? It sounds like our Nostoc were not responsible for the jelly masses he found, which is, you know, altogether kinda anticlimactic, but we kinda like that. Because over and over again in this world, people find their version of star jelly. And sometimes it's snail spawn. Sometimes it's frog spawn that's been regurgitated by a bird. One time, it even turned out to be waste from a battery treatment plant. And every once in a while, it's even Nostoc. Because while the microcosmos isn't the answer to everything, it remains a distinct possibility. Thank you for coming on this journey with us as we explore the unseen world that surrounds us. The people on the screen right now, they are our Patreon patrons. I appreciate them so much, and I'm glad to be making content again, and I have also been happy to see so many other hosts here on Journey to the Microcosmos. It's been a great time, and I am always fascinated by what we discover here. So thank you so much to everybody who supports us. If you want to be one of these people, you can go to patreon.com/journeytomicro. If you want to see more from our master of microscopes, James Weiss, you can check out Jam and Germs on Instagram. And if you want to see more from us, there is always a subscribe button somewhere nearby.